Well, I appreciate, Jenny, I appreciate your willingness to come and participate in these academic conversations. I know that you have recently been interested in and actually have organized a conference on the what we might call the economics of children or the economics of the child. And I think you do bring us all up short initially when we even start thinking about that, because I'm as guilty as most economists are that we sort of start out and assume that we're dealing with a set of fully grown people, and we never really talk at all about the fact that we are born, we grow up as children, and then we die. And certainly that's true of my own work in sort of extending economics over into politics, sort of contractarian political philosophy. We just assume everybody is full grown and never dies. So I think this is an open area that I'm pleased to see you developing. And I'd like to just get lead you on to sort of speculate a little bit, or tell us a little bit about what your project is and how you're approaching this, and then we'll get off into some of the more specific aspects.
Well, as you say, I think it's a central fact that we're born helpless, that we're not born as fully competent, contracting, choosing agents the way economics always assumes and as political philosophy always assumes. So the fact of helplessness is, in a sense, the most universal fact about human persons, because everybody goes through the experience of being a baby. So what I have been trying to do is to deal with the fact that people we can't assume that people are totally autonomous at all times, because there's a period, obviously, in everybody's life where they're not autonomous, where they're totally dependent on others. And I'm looking at that period to see just what it is that's important and what turns out to be important for economics and for political philosophy. Now, the first thing that I really work with and deal with is the issue of trust, and the fact that the person in their helplessness has to learn to trust in order to get the help that they need in order just to survive. And the children who don't get that turn out to have some very serious problems. Children who are either neglected or abused and then turn out to not be very trusting or trustworthy, they turn out to be very calculating people who almost look like a caricature of homo economicus, the person who is always out for themselves and never thinking of anyone else and never willing to inconvenience themselves for anybody else. They don't have any moral sense that includes other people.
And this is quite different, isn't it, but it's related to it, to the formation of preferences. I know you're interested in that, but this is somewhat different from essentially, as you say, we're not fully autonomous choosing agents from the time we're born. Our preferences, economists like to take preferences as given, but these preferences are themselves formed in some sort of a process. But what you're talking about is quite different from that. That's an aspect of
right.
economics of children, but the development of trust is in one sense prior to, but it is different from
yes,
that.
That's quite true. Now, the reason I got interested in the question of how preferences are formed, or that whole problem of the self, is that I had a student, a very smart student, when I was at Cornell, who said to me, you know, the reason I went into law school instead of economics is because I just thought that something was wrong with economics, because somewhere somebody has to take responsibility for the content of the self. And I thought, you know, gee, we lost another smart student to law school, and he was right. That kid's remark was completely correct, that we do have somebody, somewhere in the system, has to take responsibility for the formation of the self and the preferences. So part of the problem is, whose problem is it? That's one question. Is this a big social problem where society at large is to be responsible, both in the sense of doing the work and in the sense of bearing the costs and reaping the benefits? Well, in some sense, society plays a role. But as we know, if we collectivize something like that, then it's not going to get done very well if we say it's society's problem. So it's necessary that that responsibility be localized to the parent initially, and then ultimately to the person themselves as they as they mature, as they become capable of taking that responsibility for themselves. So the preference, the problem of forming the self is something that that initially parents have a huge role in, but ultimately the person themselves has to take some charge of. And so I, for me, what's at stake here is that I think the ordinary model of economic behavior, of economic man, has the preferences as given, as you say. It's almost like the person is a given from outside the system. That crucial point about who the person is predetermined. It's almost like a kind of predestination position. And you know, economics doesn't take a position on whether it's genetics or whatever it might be, but it's somehow given and we don't concern ourselves with it. And a person that's given in that way seems to me that's not an agent in the same way. All that person does is respond to prices. You know, and you know that you've made this critique yourself, you know, that this isn't really choosing in any meaningful sense. This is a person who's just reacting to stimuli that come in, price, income, I change, you know, that kind of thing. That's all the person can do in that model. And so what I want to try to introduce is the fact that every person is in fact a choosing agent in a deeper way. That is, they choose the content of their preferences. They have some help when they're little, but then ultimately there's a stage where we have to do some reflecting for ourselves and take some responsibility for that.
Well, I can see, and this is a very important area, and I want to get back to that, but I want to go back a little earlier to what you said. How does this itself, I can see the problem that you raise, that somebody must be responsible for the formation of the self, and it's very important, and whether this be done through the collective or whether it be done through families or through institutions, that's a very important area. Maybe we'll come back to it in a minute, but I want to tied into what you said earlier about this trust relationship.
Okay.
That's not quite the same thing.
No, it's not identical at all.
Yeah. And in a sense, what you say, it seems to me, about this trust relationship, that is, if a child does not develop this sense of trust, this interaction with other people that embodies some trust, then that child can still, a self can be formed. With a lot of these qualities that you mentioned by some group, but unless that trust is there, a certain element is lacking.